Reactive architecture is founded on what we call the reactive principles. The reactive principles are the basis for the architecture, and we're going to talk about what those principles are and how they came about. What is the history of them? So the first thing you need to understand is about the reactive manifesto. So the reactive manifesto is a document that was authored by Jonas Bonnaire, Dave Farley, Roland Kuhn, and Martin Thompson. You can see there's a link here, reactivemanifesto.org. We can follow that link, and that will take us to the actual documentation on the reactive manifesto. So if you're interested, you can certainly visit that site and you can get more detail. However, we will talk about some of the details of the reactive manifesto in this course. So the manifesto was created in response to companies trying to cope with changes in the software landscape. What happened was there were multiple groups of people who were independently developing similar patterns for solving similar problems. And I can speak personally and say that I was kind of involved, not with one of the groups that formed the foundation of this reactive manifesto, but I was working with a company that was following along in this journey. The reactive manifesto didn't exist, but we were building software components that used a lot of the things that you will find in the reactive manifesto, so that when I eventually saw the reactive manifesto, it all just kind of made sense. You know, I looked at it and said, yes, that's exactly what we were trying to do. So that's essentially what happened is, you know, Jonas Bonnaire, Dave Farley, Roland Kuhn, and Martin Thompson, they all kind of got together and looked at what was happening in the industry and came up with the manifesto. So aspects of a reactive system were previously individually recognized by the different groups, the different companies that were all working towards these goals. And the manifesto attempts to bring all of these common ideas into a single unified set of principles that everybody can kind of look at and follow. So what are those principles? So there are four basic principles of a reactive system. First and foremost, the absolute most important thing is it needs to be responsive. And we've talked about this. We've talked about unresponsive applications and what it means to be unresponsive and what the consequences of that are. So it is very, very important in the reactive manifesto that a system consistently responds in a timely fashion, always. If you look at the diagram that's shown here, you can see that all of the arrows point to responsiveness. You know, if you follow them around the circle, you follow them, you eventually everything comes back to responsiveness. Now, in order to be responsive, though, you have to be resilient. This means that a reactive system needs to remain responsive even when a failure occurs. That's pretty important because if you have a system that is responsive except when a failure occurs, well, then it's not really a responsive system, especially if failures are occurring quite frequently. So it needs to be resilient. When a failure occurs, it needs to be able to respond to that failure and continue to operate to the best of its ability. A reactive system will also remain responsive despite changes to system load. So we call this elasticity. Now, we're differentiating this slightly between scalability. In fact, if you look at an older version of the reactive manifesto, you would actually see that it was originally called scalability. But the term was changed to elastic because when we think scalable, we usually think scaling up. And that's important. We need to be able to scale up in order to meet increases in load, but we also need to be able to scale down. We don't want to be in a situation where we scale all the way up to the maximum that we need and then we never go back down because that's expensive. So elasticity implies that we can not only scale up when needed, but then when the load decreases, we can scale back down in order to conserve resources. And again, that's important in order to maintain responsiveness. If you have a system that can be responsive at a low number of users, but at a high number of users, it becomes unresponsive, then that's pointless. That's no good. And finally, all of this is built on a foundation of asynchronous non-blocking messages. It is message driven. Again, if you look at an older version of the manifesto, this would have been called event driven. However, the term event has certain connotations that we want to kind of avoid. We don't necessarily want to imply that it has to be only events. In a message-driven system or in a reactive system, you can have events. There's nothing wrong with that. But there are other types of messages which are not the events of a typical event-driven system. And those messages are perfectly acceptable as well. So we move from calling it an event-driven system to calling it a message-driven system. The key element here is that those messages should be asynchronous and non-blocking. And we're going to talk, you know, as we go about why that's important. So let's dive in more detail into responsiveness. So responsiveness is the cornerstone of usability. This is the absolute most important thing here. If you could build your system to be responsive at all times without being elastic, resilient, or message driven, then we'd be done. We wouldn't need any of those other things. The reality is you can't do that. You need the elasticity and the resilience in order to provide the responsiveness. And in order to get the elasticity and resilience, you usually need to build a system that is message driven. So responsiveness is the cornerstone of usability. That is the key thing that we're aiming for. Again, it means that systems must respond in a fast and consistent fashion, if at all possible. There may be some cases where it's not possible. If all of the hardware literally crashes, then there's not a lot we can do. We can have other hardware that we can fail over to or whatever, but there might be a period of time where it's unresponsive. So our goal is to make it fast and responsive whenever possible and as often as possible. And the reason that we do this is responsive systems build user confidence. And again, we talked about this in our earlier discussion where we talked about what are the consequences of having an unresponsive system. If we have an unresponsive system, our users are going to lose confidence and they're going to walk away. If we have a system that is responsive, then we don't have that problem. When you look at things like Google and Facebook and all of those things, they never go down, or they very, very rarely go down. If Google went down for any significant length of time for a large enough number of users, that would be a pretty big deal. Similarly with Facebook or Twitter or any of these things, they put a lot of effort into making sure that they are always responsive because it builds confidence. Now, resilience provides responsiveness despite any failures. This is achieved through a number of techniques, including replication, isolation, containment, and delegation. So if you're not familiar with those terms, replication basically means we have multiple copies. Isolation means that services can function on their own. They don't have external dependencies. Containment is a consequence of isolation. It means that if there is a failure, it doesn't propagate to another service because it is isolated. And delegation means that recovery is managed by an external component. The key here is that any failures are isolated into a single component. You know, they don't propagate and bring down the whole system. That's very important, because if we have a failure that brings down the whole system, obviously that's a problem. And that's a problem that occurs quite frequently in monolithic applications. Recovery is delegated to an external component because if you are the failing component, then you're not reliable, enough at least to handle your own failure. You know, if the system goes down, the system can't restart itself because it's down. So what you need is an external component that monitors the system and restarts it as necessary, or does whatever it needs to do to handle the failure. That's the idea behind resilience. Elasticity provides responsiveness despite increases or decreases in load. It implies zero contention and no central bottlenecks. That's the goal. We would like zero contention, no central bottlenecks. That might be a pie in the sky kind of goal. We might not be able to get there, but we're going to try to get as close as possible to that. If we have elasticity, then we can leverage predictive autoscaling techniques in order to support it. So we can actually have techniques that will look at our existing load and say, oh, I see a slight increase here, and I know from past experience that means that we're going to get a big burst of traffic coming in right away. So I'm going to scale up the system in order to be ready for that burst of traffic. We can use that kind of predictive measuring in order to provide our elasticity. Scaling up is done to provide responsiveness during peak load. But on the other hand, we also need to be able to scale down, like I mentioned before, which improves cost effectiveness. You know, again, if we're always running at peak load or always running at the capability of handling peak load, that's very expensive. So we want to be able to scale down in order to improve cost effectiveness. And finally, again, message driven. So our responsiveness, our resilience, our elasticity, these are all supported by a message-driven architecture. The messages have to be asynchronous and non-blocking, and again, we'll talk more about that later. But what this does is it provides loose coupling. It also provides isolation and something called location transparency, which we're going to go into more detail on. The idea behind this, or one of the ideas behind this, is that it allows resources to be consumed only while active. You don't have a situation where you make a request and that request is blocking, and so you're stuck waiting for a response from somebody else who may take a long time or may not respond at all, and now you're stuck waiting. And while you're waiting, you're potentially consuming a thread, you're consuming memory, you're consuming CPU cycles, you know, you're consuming any number of physical resources because you're stuck waiting for somebody who may or may not ever respond. So the idea with asynchronous non-blocking messages is you can avoid that because it means that you can send the message and then release the resources. You may still be interested in a response, but that response comes asynchronously.